Mark, let's get started, shall we? It's been 1 year this last week.
Yep.
Since the Jet acquisition. How's it going?
It's going great. You know, it. I tell this to people, and they don't believe me when I say that not a lot has changed in terms of like how we're operating and the ways of working. It feels like a startup right now. We're moving really fast, making a lot of changes, and innovating, and we're having a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's been fascinating for me to observe this because, of course, you've got, frankly, two different cultures, right? You've got a Fortune 500, a Fortune 10 company, and you've got a startup with all of the, you know, the trappings, the cultural trappings of a startup. How have you brought those two things together, culturally, organizationally, from your perch?
Sure, yeah. I think it started from day one, you know, well before the acquisition, with my first meeting with Doug McMillan. I think we just shared a common set of core values, and we're able to build a foundation of trust early on. And really, that's what it's about at the end of the day, because in order to run as fast as we're running, you know, the team has to feel empowered yeah. and be able to make moves and changes fast. Yeah. And you can't do that without there being trust. So I think there's a great foundation there, and it's been working out really well.
Yeah. I forgot to ask at the top here, how many people in the audience, and it's a little hard for us to see with the lights, have shopped on jet.com? Raise your hand. Hey, that's not bad, Mark. How many people in the audience have shopped at walmart.com? That's not bad either. You got a lot of customers in the audience. You've made a lot of interesting acquisitions over the last year. Tell me about some of them and why, because they're all different.
Sure, it's really the acquisition strategy is two-pronged. On the one side, I think we're, you know, looking for acquisitions that could help accelerate our entry into the long tail category. So we did one in home, we did one in outdoor, we did one in shoes. Mm-hmm. That's really about, you know, hiring a great merchandising team, getting great product quality, you know, product content, and they've got great relationships with vendors as well. So we wanted to accelerate that on Walmart and Jet. That's sort of like one part of the strategy. And the other part is a little more offensive in the Bonobos and ModCloth. I'm a big believer in these digitally native brands being the future, and I've seen them connect with millennial shoppers in a way that maybe brands haven't been able to do in the past. Yeah. So we were looking at building a portfolio of these brands to give us differentiated content for the website.
You know, I feel like, you know, again, as a journalist, as an observer for this category, there have been a lot of acquisitions across the category. Some of them feel like they're kind of showy, like they're a little more hype. They're meant to send more of a message than they are actually fitting in operationally. How are you looking at the ones that you've acquired? You know, how do you make sure that you get ROI out of them? Target, for example, Brian Cornell, the CEO, said their acquisitions, they now want to ROI on a 3-year, you know, timeline. How are you guys thinking about that?
Yeah, I mean, for us, again, the two different strategies, but with respect to the first strategy, it's really about trying to accelerate growth on the existing site, and it's more of an asset purchase than anything else. It's not really as much about ROI and the site that we acquired as much as what it can do to accelerate growth on Walmart and Jet, so it's a little bit different. I think the other one, the DMVBs, is really about thinking into the future.
Yeah,
and that's a little bit more strategic.
I'm glad you mentioned the future. So you're pretty well known as a future-looking guy, a forward-looking guy. Let's talk about technology. I feel like every time I come to this conference, there's a new hot technology. This year, it seems to be voice audio, right? We've all spoken to an inanimate object sometime this year, I think. How are you thinking about integrating these technologies into what you're doing, whether that's Walmart or one of the other brands? How are you thinking about them as, you know, customer acquisition, moving goods? I mean, there are a lot of ways you could use them.
Yeah. I think it's important to not look at just the technology, but what it enables. And that's really the lens that we're looking through. It's about what does it enable in terms of merchandising and logistics that maybe wasn't possible before. Even e-commerce generally and the internet, there were two different ways to look at it. You know, if you ask people what's e-commerce? If you ask people today, most people will say, well, that's about shipping goods to your door, right? When in reality, we were shipping product to people's doors for decades before the internet.
Sure.
What the internet really unlocked was it allowed us to be better merchants, which is kind of an interesting way, I think, to look at it, because we were suddenly, unlike a catalog that had a fixed number of products, you were suddenly able to merchandise millions of products, have really rich, relevant content, pictures and descriptions, and you were able to easily find the products through a search box. But really, it was just a more efficient catalog, right, at the end of the day. And I think, you know, some people maybe miss that. Like, it's really about merchandising, the e-commerce and the internet. And I think when we look at voice, I hear a lot of people talking about voice and the underlying technology and artificial intelligence and where it's going and that sort of thing, and less about what it means in terms of how it enables us to be thinking about merchandising in a different way.
Yeah.
So for example, I think voice means one best answer is going to be more important than it ever has before, because you can't just get a list of like 50 or 100 different things, right? through voice. And so having that one-to-one personalization and being really, really good at it is going to separate the winners from losers. And I haven't heard many people talking about that so specifically, but I think that's where the game's going to be won and lost. It's not really about the technology. The technology will just like the, you know, internet, it'll get commoditized pretty quickly. And so I wouldn't be chasing the tech as much as the merchandising aspect of it.
Tech is a tool. It's an enabler.
Yeah.
Store number 8. This is a really fascinating part of your business. Tell me a little bit about it.
Yeah, you know, it's really hard, I think, for big companies to innovate inside the company just because people have competing priorities. It's tough to get the best people because you want them on the biggest part of the business as opposed to a startup that's unproven. And I knew that we wanted to focus on thinking about what the next 10 or 20 years would look like in terms of where's the future of retail going.
Sure.
And I know we wanted to take some bets and a position, and we couldn't do it from within. So we started Store 8, which is basically like an internal incubation arm where we've started companies that are basically startups within Walmart, that are 100% owned by Walmart, that have a very specific mission and vision. We've hired great leaders to come in and build it as if they would a startup.
And the idea is to isolate them, that
isolate them.
Classic innovators.
Allow them to cannibalize the existing business if that's the case. Separate P&L, go out and hire separate people, evaluated in a different way, because the traditional ways of evaluating a business, very different than a startup. So trying to figure out how best to do that.
You made a few organizational changes when you took this role on. Tell me about them. Product, customer service. You made some decisions that changed the way you operate.
Yeah, when I came in, product, customer experience, the customer-facing part of the website reported into technology, and customer care reported in operations. One of the first things I did was make customer care and customer experience two direct reports to me. I think it's really important to be and have that sort of customer-centric view, and no better way to make that point than to have those people report direct. Not only do you get better people, I think, when they're at that level, but it just elevates the customer within the organization.
So. Yeah. We've got a great question from the audience. Let me ask it. How are you thinking about the role of stores, where they provide leverage, need to evolve, and I'll follow that with kind of what role does a store play in today's retail landscape?
Yeah, I think this is one of the things that gets me most excited about being at Walmart, is just being able to leverage the 4,600 stores around the U.S. that are within 10 miles of 90% of the population. What's really interesting is you know, when you think about them doubling as warehouses, they're already profitable warehouses, right? They're already there. Product is getting to these warehouses in full truckload quantities. So it's the most efficient way to get product forward deployed. So the last mile from store to home and picking are the two other capabilities you need to finish off the last piece of the puzzle. Walmart now has picking capabilities for general merchandise in every one of the stores. And in 1,000 stores, we're picking fresh produce and putting it in the trunk of your car. And we're growing that really aggressively. And it's got an 87 net promoter score, so customers love it. So we've got the capability just to pick. And we've been doing a lot of testing with delivery, both using our own associates, using crowdsource, using the Postal Service. We feel really good about how that's coming. And I feel like we can deliver faster at a lower cost than anyone else, given that footprint. So it's really exciting.
You're thinking about your stores really as an infrastructure.
It's infrastructure.
For the delivery.
Yeah, it doubles. I mean, there's no cheaper way to get product to consumers and have them go pick it off the shelf themselves, especially for low, AUR, low average unit price. Mm-hmm. If you have something that's $1 or $2, I mean, the cost to pick it alone is like $1, right? So you can see that there's no way to ship it faster. It'll always be to pick it off the shelf. But how do you marry the best of both worlds? If you really want low price on the head of the assortment, you go to a physical store. You want the very best price on the tail assortment, then we offer a pickup discount now because we ship the long tail from the FCs to the store and we avoid last mile delivery. So that's the cheapest way to get the head, the cheapest way to get the tail. If you want the most convenient way to get it, same day or 2 hours, then use the store as a fulfillment center.
Right.
So I think we're actually situated really well, and it's sort of exciting to see the pieces start to come together.
One thing that I'm interested in is the economics of this new world. the idea of, yes, we have infrastructure everywhere, but much of America is getting used to the notion of being able to get something that quickly. We've talked about this in the earlier days of e-commerce, but now it's really intense. Just a couple hours, you can get something that's really costly. How do you balance that? I mean, Walmart's known for its prices, so where do you make the money in that scenario?
Yeah, I mean, like you said, Walmart is very profitable in the store businesses right now, and has the lowest prices. And so it's important that, the different service levels are priced appropriately, and that margins made. But you're right, it is more expensive if you want something in 2 hours or same day, rather than going into the physical store. And some people, it's about saving money, and some people, it's about convenience, and we hopefully will offer people both. It's not only save money so you can live better, and sometimes living better is to have it shipped more conveniently to you.
And you think these delivery methods will stick around? They're not a fad?
No, I don't think so at all. I think it's only going to accelerate because they feed on itself. The more volume that flows through it, the more efficient it is.
Yeah.
I know even with our own associates, we're testing that in 3 stores, and not only are the associates located at the same place as the product, but we're able to sort of figure out where each associate is driving home, and we allocate the packages to minimize their distance off their commute. So really, the average distance somebody would have to travel off their commute is less than 1/4 mile.
Ah.
It's actually really efficient. Doesn't mean every order could be done that way, but a portion of them can certainly be done.
Interesting.
Yeah.
All right, we've got another question from the audience, and it's a good one. It's about marketplaces. What is your long-term view on third-party sellers in the Walmart online ecosystem? And of course, some of your famous competitors are big on third-party.
Yeah, we've got over 65 million products now and added, I don't know, about 50 million this last year. So that pipeline is looking really good. The assortment continues to grow. I'm not concerned at all about the long tail and getting product via 3P. That's going well. I think the focus really for me now is how do you make sure you have all the best-selling products in the top million? Mm-hmm. And how do you get brands that maybe traditionally haven't wanted to be on Walmart to want to be on there. So we're doing a lot of work around elevating the Walmart brand. We've moved to colored blue boxes now. They'll start to cycle through. We're redesigning the website. We're doing a lot of things to sort of change the look and feel and the branding.
Yeah. When we were talking about delivery, I forgot to ask you something. Tell me a little bit about that new pilot you just announced with, it's wild. You can just
August
walk
locked,
into something, somebody's apartment and put something in their fridge.
Yeah. We're testing that right now. We've got, somewhere around 100 people that have sort of volunteered, which is, we actually asked for volunteers and we had like 10 times more than we were prepared to sort of test with. So there's definitely the demand is there. But we're, delivering it. There's a key code outside people's door. We've been doing with August Lock where it's a one-time use code. There's a camera you could see on your phone exactly the person coming into your house, putting this stuff into the fridge and leaving. So you can, you know exactly kind of what they did when they were in there. It's funny, we sometimes hear that people say that's crazy and they would never let people come into their house, but sure. I feel like we're hearing the same kind of thing when people were talking about Airbnb and basically renting out your sort of bedroom, right? So I think we're early days, but I do think That's the future.
Are you worried about liability with that? I've been very interested in this thing, and I've spoken with the makers of August. They're the smart locks, right? You can unlock them and lock them with your smartphone. You know, when I rent out an Airbnb, I don't leave my prized guitar in the room that I rent out, but I might leave it in the room adjacent to my kitchen.
Yeah.
How do you look at that? Because you're serving a certain customer need, but you're obviously opening an entire can of worms.
Yeah, I mean, we'll see how it plays out. I think the idea that, you know, you're able on your phone to see every movement that the person makes from the time they enter to the time they leave definitely helps a ton. I think without that, it would be a much bigger issue.
Yeah. Let's come back to the acquisition. I want to know how you, a year on, maintain your spirit of entrepreneurship in such a large company. How do you make sure, you talked about the store number 8 thing.
Yep.
But how do you do it broadly within the organization? How do you make sure that you are bringing the change to Walmart that the company wanted you to bring when it hired you?
Sure, a lot of it has to do with, if I had to boil it down in one word, would be empowerment. So how do you, I think when people feel empowered and trusted, it actually goes back to Jet's core values around trust and transparency. But if you give people information and you trust them, empower them, and let them run, and have them know that they're not going to be, you know, they're going to be rewarded for taking risk. They're not going to be penalized for it. I think that's the kind of environment culture you need to create, and that'll allow people to feel comfortable running and moving fast. So some of the things we did with the acquisitions, like when we bought, you know, for example, ShoeBuy, we basically gave the keys to the CEO and said, hey, you know shoes, please run shoes now for Walmart and Jet. So anybody that was touching shoes on Walmart and Jet now reports into the CEO. It's very empowering and allows him to move really fast, right? Because he doesn't have to worry about sort of all the cross-functional, you know, problems that could occur with trying to manage, you know, 3 different sites. So that's one example.
And you still feel like that's possible within a public company that has to report quarterly earnings, that, you know, has the challenges of long-term vision?
Yeah, I think it really starts with the board and with Doug. So just the idea that, you know, e-commerce was sort of carved out as a separate entity within Walmart and had me report direct to Doug. Mm-hmm. I'm sure in other organizations you'd have the head of e-commerce, you know, report into the person that runs the retail business potentially. You know, it's a different location, so it was out in California, and now we're in Hoboken. So I think that those definitely help, you know, when you sort of have a separate P&L, business is viewed differently, you're able to move faster and stuff, so.
Structure helps.
Structure helps a lot, yeah.
Yeah. And there is yet another audience question, and this is a great one too. Will you ever charge a membership fee for your sites?
I would never say never to anything, but.
You heard him.
There are no plans to do that right now. We feel really good about how we're positioned. Free 2-day shipping with no membership is working out really well. It's a big reason why we're growing how fast we are. So, yeah, feeling really good.
And last question, just before we run out of time. You know, we talk a lot about different tech trends at this conference. Mm-hmm. Which ones are overhyped? Which ones are not worth investing in? Leave it.
Hype, which ones are overhyped? What are some examples?
Yeah.
What are some examples?
You know, we talked about voice.
Yep.
You're bullish on that.
I'm really bullish on voice.
I think you're also bullish on VR.
Yep.
And augmented reality. Is there anything that you're like, don't worry about it? Not a big deal.
I think most of the technologies, there's a time and a place for it. So it's really just, you know, what's near term and what's not. And maybe some technologies seem closer than they really are. But I think most of the technologies that I'm seeing and hearing about will eventually come to fruition. So I'm bullish in general.
Bullish on all technology, on all future.
Yeah, especially virtual reality, which it's still really early days for that. But I think, you know, the natural evolution of once you get into this voice world where people are so comfortable, you know, shopping via voice, imagine being immersed into an environment where the products that you're looking to buy are in their native environment. So you want to go and buy a tent, and there you are immersed and on the mountainside at a campsite, able to walk around the tent and ask questions about it and even sit inside it. We're not that far away from that. So that's pretty exciting.
That's extraordinarily exciting. On that note, please thank Mark for joining us.
Thank you, Angie. Appreciate it so much.